Today's topic is innovation adoption. Between these two words, innovation and adoption, usually innovation gets a spotlight. Let me explain what do I mean. What I mean is this: when we see a successful innovation, we only see innovation. Usually we fail to see that it is successful because it is widely adopted. So innovation is very charming. We get attracted by innovation. It impresses us. So it's very easy for us to identify innovation, but we fail to recognize adoption. We fail to see that behind every successful innovation, there is a successful adoption. The focus of this presentation is adoption, adoption of innovation. What we want to achieve by this presentation is three things. Number one, we want to begin to recognize adoption. Number two, we understand the importance of adoption and challenges associated with it. And number three, we want to get some knowledge about what are the tools, methods available which help us in managing adoption. So let's first train our mind so that we start identifying adoption when we see it. So let's do a little exercise here. What I'm going to do here is to share a slide in which I will show a picture. And I want you to check if your mind can recognize if it is related to adoption or not. Okay, so the next slide will show a picture and we want to test if our mind can recognize aspect of adoption associated with it. And here comes that image. What do we think? Is Baba innovating yoga, or is Baba is promoting the adoption of yoga? So when we see this kind of things, usually we fail to identify that this is a promotional activity. This is a promotion for adoption of innovation. A great deal of effort is made to get yoga adopted. And that is adoption part of it. We see it in front of our eyes, but we don't see the message. We miss the message and we don't relate it that it is related to adoption. So now let me move to the next objective and let me show you and illustrate you that how challenging it is. Yoga is free, it is beneficial for health, and it is promoted for ages by a lot of influential personalities. Yet it is not 100% adopted. What is the reason? When something is good for us, when it is free and when it is promoted by so many influential people and role model, why it is not adopted 100%? This is one indication that adoption is not easy. It is very challenging. The second biggest problem with innovation is that it is not automatic. Most of the innovators, like engineers, doctors, scientists, they expect that if innovation is good, it will be adopted automatically. They think that all we need to do is just develop something wonderful, innovate something which is useful for the society, and then onward, automatically everybody will adopt it. But mostly, it doesn't happen like that. Adoption is not automatic. It is a difficult task. It takes effort and it takes time, and usually very, very long time. So, Let me go to the next slide and show you that the timeline. An idea may come in a split of second, but to convert that idea into a product, to refine that idea and convert it into product may take months. But then once the product is ready, it may take years to get it adopted. And that's how this timeline is. To get an idea, it takes few seconds. To convert that idea into a product, it takes few months. And then to get it adopted, it takes years. So this is a long journey. Let me illustrate it with a real life case, polio drop. This is free, it is beneficial, and it is promoted by government. Yet we see there is no 100% adoption. The polio is an infectious disease, which is very, very dangerous. It is a viral. It is very painful. It affects limb. We can see that people, the polio affected people, how do they look like? And sometimes it is very dangerous. It leads to paralysis and death. The vaccine was developed in 1950. And then it took 38 years for WHO to start a vaccine drive. And in 1988, which is 38 years after the vaccine was developed, WHO and UNICEF and Rotary Club, they started this polio program. And then from then to now, 1988 to now, it's about 32 years. Every government have been promoting polio drop. Celebrities have been promoting polio. For example, in India, we have Amitabh Bachchan promoting polio. And then 70 years from the discovery of polio vaccine, or 32 years of continuous effort by various government, still it is not 100% adopted. In the year 2020, there was 1,084 polio cases reported from 26 countries. So that means it is not only in one country. 26 countries still have polio cases. That means the drop is not adopted 100%. And there are people who have not adopted it. It took about 70 years. Imagine. That shows the difficulty of adoption. Let's take example of some basic technology, very, very useful technology such as electricity. To achieve 90% adoption in US market, it took 47 years for electricity to achieve 90% adoption in US market. Telephone took 75 years to achieve 90% adoption. Radio took 23 years to achieve 90% adoption. So if we take average of these three technology, it takes about 50 years to achieve 90% adoption in an advanced country like US. So even that advanced country has not achieved more than 90% adoption for such thing like electricity, telephone, and radio in less than 50 years. That shows that it takes very, very long time. So in conclusion, yoga, some people say that it was originated from Indus Valley. If so, it has been 5,000 years. And some people link it that it came from Vedic period. If so, it is about 2,500 years. So anyway, 2,500 years to 5,000 years. Very useful concept and beneficial to everyone. And it is free and promoted by many, many influential people, yet we don't have 100% adoption. Polio vaccine was developed about 71 years ago. It is another very useful invention, very useful because it protects us from polio. As you know, polio has no cure. Once somebody is infected by polio, you cannot cure it. The only cure for polio is prevention. And the prevention can be done by vaccine. And this vaccine in that context is very useful. It is free of charge. Government bring it to your doorstep. And yet after 71 years of hard work, we don't have 100% adoption. Three basic technology, even in an advanced market like US, it takes about 50 years to achieve 90% adoption. So adoption takes very, very long time. This is another example. Everybody here, I think, knows QWERTY keyboard. That is a keyboard layout, QWERTY. Our keyboard has this layout. It is not simple A, B, C, D. The arrangement of the keys are not in sequence to what our alphabets are. This layout was developed by Mr. Sholay in 1970s. And you may be surprised to know this layout was designed to slow down the typing speed. Yes, I repeat, this design layout, this layout was designed to slow down typing speed. Why anybody would like to do that? And the reason is very simple. Back in those days, we had this mechanical typewriter, which was powered by your finger and gravity. So when we push a keyboard, we use power of finger. And then when we release the finger from there, the key goes back based on the power of force of gravity. So because it was based on the gravity, there was one weakness of this design, and that was if two adjacent key are pressed in succession quickly, there used to be a key jam. And in order to avoid that key jam, slowing down the typing was required. So by slowing down the typing speed, they maximize the overall performance of the typewriter and overall performance of speed of typing. And that design was wonderful. But then later on, when technology developed and we don't have any longer that gravity-based typewriter. In fact, we don't have any mechanical typewriter. We are using electronic keyboard. There is no need to have this quality design, which was designed for that, to solve that problem. So in 1932, Professor Dvorak designed another keyboard layout. And this was done based on the hand and motion study. He took video of many people typing, and then they calculated that what is the optimum way to rearrange these keys. And based on that, he proposed this layout, which you can see on the screen. The research shows that it decreases typing speed. It increases the typing speed. It reduces error. It improves the typing rhythm. And it reduces the repetitive strain and injuries, and it is more comfortable. So let me ask this question. How many of you are using this Dvorak keyboard? I guess nobody is using it. Let me ask another question. Have you ever used this keyboard? And I guess answer is no. And I will ask the third question. Have you ever heard this name before this presentation? And if your answer is no, that is a proof that this wonderful innovation, which is very useful, is not adopted at all. So not only that innovation is difficult to adopt, it is challenging. Not only that it takes long time and a lot of effort, sometimes it don't even get adopted. And a good innovation, if it is not adopted, is a wastage. And that we have never heard the name of this keyboard is an indication that how this good innovation was never adopted. And then you may have doubt whether this keyboard is really better than the quality or not. I suggest if you want to investigate, go and search it on Google Scholar. And you will find many, many reports comparing the performance of QWERTY and Dvorak. And you will be surprised to see that everybody has reported, though somebody has reported 4% improvement and somebody has reported tremendous improvement over QWERTY, but everybody has reported that it is better than QWERTY. Yet we don't see it in practice. That is very, very unfortunate. And that happens with many innovations, not only this. So the next slide, I'm trying to understand why adoption is important for two reasons. An innovation is translated into commercial benefit, and innovation is translated into social benefit by means of adoption. If there is no adoption, innovation doesn't get translated into social and commercial benefit. And innovation is good, innovation is great, but no matter how good or how impressive an innovation is, if it doesn't get adopted, then it doesn't generate social and commercial value. That is just a wastage of good innovation. So if that is the case, everybody is concerned about all the designers and all the business. Of course, they are concerned about how to improve the rate of adoption of innovation. So to improve the rate of adoption, many studies have been conducted. A lot of concept constructs model, framework, and formulas have been developed, which help us in managing the adoption and improving the adoption. So we are going to discuss some of them today. So before we proceed, what I wanted to conclude is that it's very easy to see innovation, but we always ignore adoption, and sometimes we cannot see the adoption. But adoption is very important. If there is no adoption, innovation doesn't generate the social and commercial value and the social and commercial benefit. So if we fail to generate social and commercial benefit, then the innovation is useless. Adoption of innovation is challenging. It takes effort, it takes time. And the worst part of it is that sometimes, even though an innovation is good, it doesn't get adopted at all. And then all the people who are into field of innovation, or the people who are in business and they develop a new product and technology and they do R&D, they would like that their investment and their innovation gets adopted, because that is how they make money. So how to improve rate of adoption have been a topic of interest for business and for society, and also for academicians. So it started in 1903. Mr. Trade proposed in his book Law of Imitation that adoption of innovation follows a kind of S curve, S-shaped graph. So over a time, it starts slowly and it increases, and then it flattens adoption. So this is the curve it looks like when an innovation is adopted over time. This is a very simple curve, but this was proven to be mother of all the concepts which was developed based on these curves. That's why Trade is sometimes regarded in field of innovation adoption as forefather of innovation adoption, because many tools and model which are developed are based on this curve. So I will go to the next slide. So from that S curve, people developed another curve, which was a bell-shaped curve. And what is the relationship between two is that the S-shaped curve is cumulative adoption. Cumulative adoption means if we take, let's say that the mobile phone, mobile subscription. So today we have 10 customers subscribing to our mobile services, then we have 10 customers. Tomorrow there is another 120 customer subscribing our services. So total today we have 220 customers. That 220 customer is cumulative, but the new customer is 120. So that is a new customer or new adopter. Then third day, 200 people comes. That means 420 is my cumulative quantity and 200 is my new customer. So that is the relationship between this cumulative adoption and the new adopter. New adopter follow a bell-shaped curve, and cumulative adoption follows an S-shaped curve. I will go to the next slide. So interestingly, this curve, S and bell-shaped curve, is very similar to virus, spread of virus. If we see COVID cases, we can see the new cases, which is represented by this bar chart, light blue color, is almost similar to bell shape. And the dark blue line, which is an S shape, which shows the total infected cases. So the spread of virus is very similar to spread of adoption, spread of innovation. In fact, the spread of virus and chain reaction of nuclear power is very similar to adoption of innovation. The spread of innovation and spread of virus and spread or chain reaction of nuclear power is very similar. One person who is affected by virus will affect more than one person, and that's how the virus grows. One person who adopts a new technology, and if he likes the new technology, he will share that idea to other friends and people. And then more than one people will get influenced and they will adopt that technology. So that's how it multiplies. And when this happens, there is an exponential growth. So that explains this part A of this bell curve, that it starts slow, but then it becomes very rapid, and then it goes to the peak of adoption, and then it decreases. Why does it decrease? Growth is very easy to explain. It should increase because it is multiplying. But after some times, it decreases. What is the reason for decrease? So then this slide is explaining how come that growth is not exponential growth, but after some times it decreases. The reason for that is there are three lines. The first one is green line, which shows that there are total number of population which are good and they are not infected by virus. So I'm explaining with help of, let's say that the COVID virus. Initially, the population of India before COVID came, everybody was not infected, and this population is considered as susceptible population which may be infected if virus come to India. And then the virus came. And when virus came, few people got infected by the virus. And this pink line is showing that how many people are getting affected by virus, new cases. So let's say that initially 100 people got affected. This 100 people will be reduced from the green line, because once a virus is infected a person, the person will be immune to that virus and he will not get the COVID again. So if population of India is X when there is no virus, and then virus is affecting Y number of people, then those people who remain which can be affected is X minus Y. And that's how this green chart, green line slowly decreases as pink line increases. The blue line is what? Blue line is those people who recovered from COVID. That means they got infected and then they recovered, assuming that there is a zero death. So the people got infected after a few times, they become cured from it, and they will not get COVID again. So these are the infected population, which will not be contributing to the new cases, because they have infected, they cannot be infected again. So the green line will contribute to pink line, because those are the people who will be infected. Blue line doesn't contribute to pink line, because the infected people don't get the second infection. So we can see the pink line growing up, 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 and the green line going down. Then there comes a point where green line crosses over the blue line. That means even though pink is at peak and there are many, many infected people, they should multiply and they should infect more number of people next day. But since there are not enough people to be infected and the green is less than the blue, the number of cases is bound to drop, because though person who is going to infect are more, the person who can be infected are less. And that's how the graph grows down. And then initially there is a rapid decrease and then there is a slow decrease. So this explains how it goes up and then it goes down. Now then, we are always focusing on this pink line, because these are the new cases. If we talk about innovation or new product or new service, we would like to people to adopt our new product and new service, and we can expect that initially few people will adopt it, and then more people will adopt it, and more people will adopt it, and then it will reach to the peak, and then slowly it will go down. So what we are going to get for our new customer is a bell-shaped curve. So all innovation adoption studies will focus on bell-shaped curve. This slide shows that those bell-shaped curve and all the adopter are not same. They are different. That means the people who adopt a technology initially, their character and their nature is not same as the people who adopt the technology at the last. So these adopter are divided into five categories based on various research, and then we know their characteristics are different. So for example, whenever there is a new product, we have these 2.5% people who are very, very enthusiastic, and they are enthusiastic and they are always like newness. Anything new, they have to adopt it. So what this category is called innovators. These are those people who watch, when a movie is released, they watch first day, first show. movie is good or bad, it doesn't matter. All they care is that they would like to be the first one to watch that movie. And that's why they go on first day, first show. These are the people who queue up at Apple store when new phone is released. They don't care whether the new phone has bugs or it doesn't have bug, whether it is better than the previous one or not better than previous one, whether the benefit is better than the cost or not, nothing matters to them. They are motivated by newness. So whenever people like Apple or these kind of companies are introducing a new product, this innovator would like to be the first one to have that product. So they do the advanced booking, they queue up at the store, and then they take that product. They are highly motivated by newness of the product rather than whether it is good or bad or benefit or not benefit. These are the same people whose laptop you will find the latest version of software. All the software you will find the latest version. Even though latest version has a bug, it doesn't matter to them. Even though latest version is not as good as the previous version, it doesn't matter to them. If there is a new version, they are likely to download the new version immediately because they are motivated by newness. Then after this kind of people are 2.5% in the society based on the various statistics and research, roughly 2.5%, depending on the product, of course. Then next 13.5% are those people who are early adopter. They are visionary. They see the benefit. If they see that this product is better than the previous product, they are going to take it. If they see that this movie is good, they are going to watch it. If they see that this software is bug-free and it is better than the previous version of software, they will download it. This is what we call is early adopter. Then we come to the third, which is early majority. Early majority doesn't look at the benefit only. They look at the cost. They see the cost is how much and the benefit is how much, and this cost-benefit analysis should make sense. Otherwise, they don't change it. So these are the pragmatic people. They are not motivated only by the benefit. They will see that, okay, this benefit comes at what cost and whether it is worth or not. And when they see that this cost is worth the benefit, then only they are going to take it. This is what we call is early majority. Thereafter, we have this 34%. 34% is early majority and the 34% is late majority. So this one is the bulk of the customer. 64% is a huge percentage. So the fourth one is late majority. Late majority is a conservative people. They just don't believe in cost benefit. They also believe is that the cost benefit is just expectation. Whether it is really beneficial or not, I need to wait and I need to see. So they look for verification. They wait for the validation. It is unlike the early majority. Early majority will just check that, okay, these are the benefit which is claimed and this is the cost, which is the cost of the product. And then this cost benefit analysis makes sense. So let me go ahead and adopt this product. But then it is not yet validated whether those benefit is really coming or not coming, whether this cost is the only cost or there is a hidden cost. So this will be validated over a period of time. Late majority wait for that validation. And once they have this concrete information from early majority that yes, this is the cost, this is the benefit, and this is the total verified value of it, then the late majority people will adopt it. And the last one is laggard. These are the people who try to skip. They don't like to change unless they are forced to change. These are the people whose laptop probably is still using Windows 95. And they will continue to use Windows 95. They will say that kaam to chal raha hai, why do we need to change it? Unless it comes to the point where the new version is not working, support has stopped, their internet doesn't work, when they do their college work, their version is not supported, they cannot deposit their fees, they cannot apply for their leave based on that Windows 95, then they will be forced to change. We have 16% such people who don't like change. So these are the five categories, and these categories are very, very important when you are managing or promoting your innovation. I will go to the next slide. The next slide is another interesting concept. It shows that out of these five categories, The first two categories are different, and the last three categories is different. The first two categories, which is innovator and early adopter, 2.5% and 13.5%, total is 16%. These people are early market, and these people are motivated by newness. These people are visionary. They appreciate innovation and they support innovation. But then the next three categories, which is early majority, late majority, and laggard, which is rest of the population, they are not very pro innovation. They are pro value. They see that what is benefit for me, whether it makes sense to adopt this innovation or not. And if that innovation is beneficial, then only they adopt it. So we have seen in many, many innovation that a new innovation comes, and because innovator will adopt anything which is new, they get adopted. And this gives a false hope to the innovator that, oh, my product has started selling. So good, it will sell to everyone. Not so, because the adopter is motivated by newness and your product is new, so it gets adopted. The innovator has adopted it doesn't mean that the subsequent category will adopt it. Similarly, early adopter always are pro innovation, so they will see the benefit, and of course if your new product has benefit, they will adopt it. But the real litmus test comes when you want to migrate from early adopter to early majority. There, just newness is not enough. Just showing the benefit is not enough, because they are the practical people. They will see what is the cost of getting this benefit, whether that cost benefit analysis makes sense or not. And if your product cannot show that cost benefit analysis and advantage, then they would not like to change. So as a result of that, a lot of innovation will fail after first 16%. And that's why this research shows that there is a chance, there is a gap between early market and mainstream market. And many, many innovation will fall into this chasm or this gap and will not be able to go beyond that. And if that happens, that is very bad for any innovation. The reason for that is very simple, because initial part of innovation is all about investment. You don't make money. You develop technology, that is an investment. Then you promote it to innovator, there is a cost of promotion. And the revenue is not enough, depending on your innovation, it is not enough to recover your R&D cost. And your marketing cost initially is very high. So your cash flow go even low. The investment goes up and then the revenue is less. Then you move to early adopter. Still, a lot of marketing is needed, so you don't recover from your R&D. It is only when you go to the mass market, you start making money, and then you get return on your investment, return on your R&D. So you can see, once you cross this half line, then the cash flow increases rapidly. That means if early majority and late majority, if they adopt your product, your innovation is going to make a lot of money. But if early majority and late majority is not going to adopt, only those people who like the new thing, they are going to adopt it, then your product is not going to make money. It is very similar to movie. When a new movie is released, it is not that nobody see it. There would be people going to first day, first show and watching your movies. But then after one day, after 2 days, when people know about the quality of movie and when the reviews are out, and initial customer talk about it, whether good or bad, it is that time when it is decided whether movie will be flop or super hit. And if it flops, despite few days collection, there is loss. And the project is loss making project. But if it is hit and early majority and late majority adopts it, then movie makes a lot of money. It is very similar to innovation, and it is very similar to other R&D project where a lot of investment goes. We must able to win the early majority and late majority. If not, the initial adopter is not going to make this project profitable, and crossing the chasm is very important. Next. Now, in order to increase the rate of adoption, And in order to cross the chasm, a lot of model and constructs are found on in the literature. And these models, we are not going to discuss the detail. I'm going to just pass various models so that you know these models exist. So this model is the technology acceptance model. It was presented by Mr. Davis in 1986. It has a construct of usefulness and ease of use. So according to this model, if the product is useful and if product is easy to use, then eventually people will buy it. The next model has a, in addition to usefulness, it has a subjective noun that shows that if other people have adopted it, people will adopt it. And then this is called theory of reasoned action. Another model has a three variable, which is the usefulness, the subjective norm, and perceived behavior control. This is called theory of planned behavior. These are all available on the literature. You can read the detail. I'm not going to discuss detail of everything because time is limited, but I just wanted to let you know what kind of models are available to manage your adoption. The next one is Roger's diffusion of innovation, and then there are various components, basically attribute of innovation, and then there are five sub-attributes, then type of innovation decision-making, and then there are three items there, and the communication channel, nature of social system, and extent of change agents promotion effort. All these things are going to affect your rate of adoption. So the attribute of innovation is very important. If other things are there, that means if you are managing your innovation, of course, you are the change agent, you will promote it. Whatever is the social system is there, you cannot change it. It is beyond your control. Whatever is the communication channel you are going to choose, whether you are going to promote it on social media or mass media or print media, once you decide it, then there is not much to be done about it. Similarly, the type of decision making, whether it is optional or authority, once it is decided, then you have to deal with it. So the only thing which is within your control is attribute of innovation. And this is perceived attribute of innovation. That means perception of customer about relative advantage, compatibility, complexity, trialability, and observability. This is within your control. So most of the people and practitioner to increase the rate of adoption basically tries to control these five things. How this is going to help us and how it is used in industry, I would like to share some example. So let's take the example. Before that, this is something about communication channel. I will skip it. And then this model I would like to share, that is a bus model. This is based on that bell-shaped curve. They have designed a mathematical equation to predict the time of adoption and how many people will adopt it. So if you have initial data, you use this initial data to fit this curve, and then it can forecast the future data. So if you have data for innovators and 2% or 5% people have adopted your product, those data can be used to predict how much it will sell and at what time it will sell how much. So that is very good for forecasting. This is called BAS model. And then for organization innovation, we have few models. There are two of them. I will just show it here. This is Roger's model. And the next one is what we call is TOE model, technology, organization, environment, adoption model. This is for organization adoption or adoption by business. So I will come to this case studies, how this model, relative advantage, compatibility, complexibility, trialability, help in managing adoption and rate of adoption. So the case study, I have selected two for today's lecture. One is online shopping. When online shopping was introduced initially, at that time, there was a lot of doubt whether people will like to buy online or not. Today, we see it is a successful thing and everybody does online purchase. But back at that time when online was introduced as an innovation, at that time, there were a lot of doubt about its success. if you take the newspaper and if you take the magazines and research paper at that time, a lot of people had this question mark, whether people would stop buying from shop and would like to buy online or not, and what are the advantages and what are the disadvantages. And one of the key concerns was that people predicted when you go to shop, when you buy a product, let's say that you're buying a shirt, you can see the shirt, you can touch the shirt, you can see it in different lightings, and you can even try it on. So this shopping experience of touching, looking, smelling, trying it on is very, very important. When you buy something online based on the picture, you don't know how will it touch. You don't know how will it feel on your skin. You don't know how good it will fit. You don't know how will you look. You can only imagine. So this is the biggest concern. Now, if we compare that with these five attributes, the relative advantage of product is same, because the product what you are buying, assuming that you are buying same shirt on the shop or online, so product is same, so advantage of that product is same, compatibility of that product is same, complexity of that product is same, and observability of that product is same. The only difference here is the trialability. In shop, you can try that product, so it is less risky for you. You know how it feels on your skin, you know how it fits on your body, you know how will you look. So this is less risky. When you buy it online, you cannot try it. So it is more risky. And the product may come and you may not like the touch, you may not like the feel, it may not fit you well. So that is the risk. So because of the trialability, there was a lot of doubt that online business will not work. And based on this model, they find a way to manage this shortcoming. And the solution is very simple. What they proposed is 14 days refund, replacement, and exchange. So now, if you buy online, you are taking risk, but that is not a risk because I will refund full money if you don't like the product. Why you don't like the product, whether it doesn't fit, whether the touch is not good, whether the color is not good, whether the overall texture and everything which you couldn't see on the picture is not up to your satisfaction, then you have three choices. You can refund it if you don't like the product. You can replace it if you want to buy another color. Or if the size is not same, you can exchange it, same thing for a different size, one size bigger, one size is smaller. So by designing this 14 days, refund, replacement, and exchange, they are able to solve that one of the major roadblock of adoption. And now we know that online business is becoming big. And if you see the purchase on online is increasing day by day. And you also see that every online platform are offering for most of the products free replacement, whether it is for 14 days or whether it is 7 days or whether it is 1 day, that depends on, of course, product. But there is always a method to refund it. Even sometimes the timeline to refund is 1 day. That is okay. But that means you can, once product come to you, you can check and you can see, feel, test, and smell it. And if you don't like it, you can return it. And that is overcoming one of the biggest concern of the consumer. And by overcoming that concern, by solving that concern, you get adoption for online business. So that's how this model can help in designing and improving the adoption. The second case study is about observability. I will take two products here. One is shampoo. When you use a shampoo, immediately we know how useful that product is because we can see and we can feel that hair become light and silky and it flies on air. So you can see the effect of shampoo. You know that it works. And that means if we talk about these five attributes, relative advantage, compatibility, there is a last point, which is observability. You are able to observe the benefit of the product when you use a shampoo. When we go to water purifier, there was a big concern in mind of customer because the water which you put in and the water that comes out looks same. And the customer has this doubt that this is a water purifier, but does it purify? You are not able to see or observe the result claimed by this company or this product, that it is a water purifier and it will purify your bad water into good water, and it will purify all the bacteria. You cannot see the bacteria. It will purify all the minerals. You cannot see the minerals. So whether this is actually working or not working is very difficult to see. We cannot observe the result of the benefit claimed by this company, because the water which goes in, water which comes out looks very similar. So based on this adoption model, once again, we know relative advantage is there, because we are claiming that the clean water is good for your health and people will like it. Compatibility is there because it requires electricity, and if your home has electricity, then it is compatible, and it requires online water supply. So there are two versions, online and offline. And if your home doesn't have online water system, that means 24-hour water supply, you can use offline. So compatibility is there. Complexity is not there. Product is very easy to use, and trialability can be facilitated based on the demo, or it can be facilitated based on the exchange policy or return policy. The biggest problem is observability. People who are using it is not confident. They are not confident. They are not able to observe the benefit which is claimed by this product. So whether it works or not, that is the biggest concern, and not many people adopt it. To solve this problem, what they did is very simple. They put Coca-Cola or Pepsi as input, and they demonstrated that output is a clean water. No color, no taste, no sweetness, no smell. And once you demonstrate, it shows that, okay, it really, really works. It is removing all the content which are mineral, color, and taste, and what you are getting is pure water which doesn't have color, which is not sweet, and which doesn't have smell. And this undisputedly proves that the product is working and it does the purification. And then the adoption of the product increased very rapidly. So that's how people can manage the rate of adoption. And I have 2 minutes and left, and that was my last slide. Thanks a lot. If you have any questions, I would be happy to answer it.
Thanks, Dr. Loya. If you are willing to ask any question, please unmute yourself and ask.
Good evening, sir.
Dr. Loya.
Yes, sir.
I'm Professor P.K. Singh. I'm able to see that you have mentioned this Flyers technologies. So just I want to know what exactly you have done with Flyers technology.
Same thing. I don't develop technology. I only work on adoption of technology. So in case of Flyers, it is very interesting. A lot of fund was supported to NIT and IIT and various institutions. And various institutions use that fund to develop a lot of useful product using fly ash. And then I was looking at those list of the product. Fly ash can be used for brick making, cement, fertilizer, pesticide, paint, crystal making, granite making. The list is very long. And I was using that list to calculate if everybody use the fly ash, how much fly ash will be needed. For example, if we use cement, all production of cement goes based on the fly ash, how much fly ash will be needed. So if all the technology developed by IIT and NIT are utilized, then there will be acute shortage of fly ash, because demand will be far higher than the supply, and the fly ash would be sold at some price. But what we see is that despite those technology, we have still a lot of fly ash lying around and nobody is taking it, and government is telling power plant that you must utilize fly ash, and if you don't utilize fly ash, there will be this penalty and that penalty. So this is very interesting contrast. At the one hand, we have so many technology developed by NIT and IIT which will help industry to reduce the cost if they use the technology, but on the other hand, industry is not using those technology, and as a result of that, fly ash problem is not solved. So this is a problem of adoption of innovation by industry. So my study was why industry is not adopting it, what are the key hurdles, and how we can increase the rate of adoption for industry so that the technology developed by NIT and IIT can put into use by industry, and industry can use the fly ash and benefit from it, and we solve the problem of fly ash. So I did not develop any new technology. I only studied what is the hurdle in adopting fly ash technology by the people.
Sir, I have to say one thing.
Yes, sir.
A small contradiction I have, I would like to share with you.
Yes, please.
As you are telling, this is not being adopted. I have worked in cement industry for roughly 25 years.
Yes.
I would like to share with you that fly ash utilization in our country.
Yes.
We have produced, last year, we have produced roughly around 329 million tons of cement.
Yes.
Out of that, roughly 70% was the cement where more than 30% fly ash was used.
That is
so
true.
I have a little contradiction. Yeah, contradiction with your statement.
No, it is not contradiction.
Well accepted by cement industry. It has been used.
It is not contradiction, sir. Out of 100 utilization of fly ash, out of 100 product which can use fly ash, one product which has used to the maximum is cement industry. And the second product which has used it to some extension is the brick, which is autoclave brick or normal brick or fly ash brick. Only these two industry has used fly ash. There are 98 industry which do not use the fly ash. If we have another 5 industry using fly ash, cement people have to pay for the fly ash to get the fly ash.
Yeah, you are right, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Welcome, sir.
Good evening, sir. Are you listening to me, sir?
Yes, Mr. Sandeep, I can listen to you.
Okay, so it was a nice talk. I would request you and Dhananjay sir to arrange your lecture for the students also. So this was quite eye-opening, or you can say very good lecture. Sir, I would like to know your views about the substitute product in that particular curve. So the curve which you have talked about, maybe the BAS model or the other model which you are talking about. What is the means role of substitute product in the adoption of a particular, say, innovation?
Yeah. So BAS model is mother model, which is very simple model. And after that, Dr. BAS had many, many students working on different models, because what Dr. BAS did is that he simplified it so much and he took out all the complications. And then this model was produced, and their student came, and then one by one, those complication was introduced. One of the assumption of BAS model is absence of substitute product. And then there is already a PhD on this, and a substitute product model is also available. There is a successive S curve, and you can search Google Scholar. Plenty of research paper is available for successive and replacement product using BAS model.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Welcome, sir.
Okay, good evening, Dr. Loya.
Yes, Dr. Mahesh, I can listen to you.
Yeah, so I was a bit skeptical when you showed a graph starting from early innovators to laggards.
Yes, sir.
So I was thinking that if you add a third component, which is age, I hope the age will play a significant role, because if you take age bracket of your 15 to 25 years, then innovators are more.
Yes.
They are early acceptors. They take it without bothering about the risk and all. So
correct,
if you could show a plot where the third part, which is the age of innovators or the acceptors or the early receivers, if that can be one axis, it would be nice to see the impact.
Yes, sir. If you read this adopter category, this adopter category has a demographic inclination also, and it is well documented that most of the innovators are early age people, because they adopt technology quickly, and as you grow old, your adoption becomes less. So age is one of the factor. Your income is another factor. Exposure to developer are another factor. People who are into industry, they try to adopt things faster than the people who are working at farm. So when if you go into detail of each product category, you will find demographic, psychographic, and many other factors, which is detailed documentation is there, because 80 years of research in this field, and very, very interesting field, because everybody want to get money out of their innovation. A lot of work is already done. And what you are mentioning is correct. Age is one of the factor, but it is already reported in the literature.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful lecture. It's very informative.
Any other questions, sir?
Hello. Can you hear me, sir? This is Dr. Modi, sir.
Yes, Dr. Modi, how are you?
I'm fine, sir. Very impressive lecture, sir. And as I could have understood that this adoption of innovation is basically influenced by n number of parameters, as Mahesh sir was mentioning, like some demographic factors are there, social economic factors are there, or other factors are also there, right? And arrival of some other innovative product in market also affect the prospect of the new product. So there are in past as well, we have seen so many examples, like as you have mentioned that yoga. So yoga is totally free, but still that has not been adopted 100% by now. There are examples which involves a certain cost or which are very costly, or initial investment to adopt those technologies are very huge. So there are examples like that. But in both the cases, we have observed that adoption has been, we cannot predict, in fact, the adoption in proper way. So I just wanted to know that if this design thinking process can improve the possibility of adoption or adopting any innovative technology.
That's right, sir. This model are actually designed to improve the rate of adoption. But later on, people started thinking that can we design a product which has high possibility of adoption? So why don't we use this outcome, which is going to happen at the control stage, at the design stage, so that we design a product which is designed in a such a way which improves the adoption. And a lot of this model are used as a design consideration when you design it. And design thinking is precisely the tool which is most used to design a product which has high chances of commercialization. So you are right, and I'm happy that you mentioned it, that design thinking is a tool which can help your innovation to make it more successful commercially, and you have more chances of winning business and adoption and making money and commercializing the product if you use the design thinking at the time of designing. Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much.
You are welcome, sir.
So is there any more question from audience side?
Dhananjay, I think you can thank Loya sir and have another session some other day. Wonderful.
Sure, sir. So for the vote of thanks, I would like to request Professor Pramod Kumar Singh, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Mishra. First of all, I feel privileged to be invited to put a vote of thanks to an eminent personality, Dr. I.M. Loya, who has delivered talk on of innovation today at JP University of Engineering and Technology, Guna. It is believed that commercialization of innovation is highly fruitful for economic growth of any country, and we are able to see that Dr. Loya is engaged in this activity for last 3 decades. All participants are fortunate enough to be part of this technical lecture by Dr. I.M. Loya, who has covered conversion of innovation into adoption beautifully. I, Professor P.K. Singh, on behalf of JP University of Engineering and Technology, and on his own behalf, heartily thank Dr. I.M. Loya. Wonderful session. I am also thankful to the Vice Chancellor of this university, Professor J.S.P. Raiji, for arranging this session for the benefit of all of us. I am also thankful to Dr. Dhananjay Mishra, a startup coordinator at JP University of Engineering and Technology, for arranging this session for all of us. And we would like to have another session told by Brigadier Rawatji. Last but not the least, I am thankful to all the participants for attending this session. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.